All right, we've got some participants filtering in. Hello, everyone. Hello. Feel free to use the chat function. Let us know where you're tuning in from.
Hello. Welcome to the show. Lights here a little bit.
We also have a Q&A function, so if you have any burning questions, please feel free to use that chat box or that Q&A box to ask Dean any questions related to directing and animation.
That's right.
Hi,
Yeah,
Josh.
we'll,
Hi,
I guess we'll just
Yvette.
see about the timing. This, I'm not sure if this will run short. And if it does, then we'll have more time for
We'll
questions.
play it by
So
ear. No
we'll play it by
problem.
ear. It'll all be good. It'll work out fine. But
All right,
welcome,
just
everybody.
give a couple of minutes for attendees to filter on through.
Yeah, no problem. No problem at all.
Dean, is that your home office that
It
you're
is. Yeah.
calling in from?
Yep,
I
that's
see
my
the Iron
animation desk
Giant
back,
behind
my
you.
old school 2D animation desk from
Oh, that's amazing.
actually from Warner Brothers when I worked there. They weren't doing too much 2D anymore, and so they were selling off all these desks that they had like custom built, like
Wow.
500 desks for their feature animation department way back in the 90s. And they eventually just sold them all off and put up a thing if you want to buy one. And I couldn't get me and my truck there fast enough to go
That
pay and pick one up and take it home.
desk must come with a lot of history.
It does, yeah. Yeah, it's cool. It comes also with a lot of weight. It's very heavy. And to move it around takes a few people and a lot of dismantling and but yeah.
Well, it looks like you're set up in
We're
a
set
good
up
spot
here.
there. So
Yep.
hopefully you won't have to lug that around anywhere.
Yeah, no, I this is its resting place for the rest of its life. It'll leave this room and as firewood if it ever does.
All right. It looks like we've got a few more attendees.
Okay.
I think we can go ahead and get started. Hello, all. Welcome to our AVG pre-apprenticeship speaker series. We're so glad that you could join us. This speaker series from the Bric Foundation aims to provide awareness and education about all the wonderful and exciting careers that exist across animation, visual effects, and gaming. My name is Sarah. I'll be your moderator for today's presentation, and I'm also Bric's Director of Communications. For those of you who may not know Bric, we are a nonprofit org dedicated to increasing representation across entertainment, gaming, media, and tech. And today we have a fantastic presentation all about directing and animation brought to you by industry pro Dean Wellins here. We'll first get started with a brief introduction, getting to know Dean before Dean jumps into his presentation, and then conclude with a Q&A at the end of the session. So as you'll see, there is a Q&A box. So just a reminder, if you do have any questions along the way, feel free to throw them in that box and we'll be sure to address them towards the end. And with that, I'm so pleased to introduce Dean. Dean is an award-winning animation director with more than 27 years of experience. Dean has held many roles as animator, story artist, writer, director across a number of esteemed animation studios and beloved films. His credits include Warner Brothers' The Iron Giant, which you can see in the corner of his screen right there, Osmosis Jones, Walt Disney Animation's Treasure Planet, Tangled, Princess and the Frog, Frozen, Big Hero 6, Zootopia, Moana, Raya and the Last Dragon, and Disney Plus's Baymax series. Currently, Dean is directing an unnamed feature project at Paper Games as well. So, welcome, Dean. I'll let you take it away from here.
All right. Well, thank you, sir. And welcome everybody. Welcome to the show. Happy to be here. Happy to share a little bit of my experience as a, not only as a director, but just as an artist and an animation lover and somebody who grew up with it. And now, I'm lucky enough to get to do it as a, as a life, as my career. and hopefully keep going with it. So all of you out there that are aspiring, you know, filmmakers and animators and, you know, artists in general, if you just like illustrating, you know, it's good to have a skill that no one else has or very little of the population has. So, you know, don't stop pushing yourself. So I can jump in if we're ready to do that. Should I jump in?
Okay. Go ahead.
I will do that. Let me get back to my screen here. Let's start from the beginning. And hold on a second. Let me get back to
all good.
The share page. Sharing. Share sound is on. And I'm going to do the keynote. And share. All right. So here we go. This is me. If you haven't already seen me, here I am again with a suit on, with a nice jacket on. So I am an animation director. We're working at Paper Games right now. And we're working on a feature film right at the moment, the very early stages. Sort of just, you know, writing the basic story down right now. And we'll hopefully get to the point where we're writing a screenplay soon. That's our goal, but very early stages right now. So where did I start? So, you know, I think a lot of this will kind of be where I began. So you can kind of see that maybe it's similar to where you are now and where you could possibly go, you know. So I grew up in an Air Force family. Basically, in the Central Valley of California. My dad was in the Air Force, and that's me right there. So I grew up in the Central Valley and grew up in a town called Merced, which is up near Fresno. And, you know.
Oh, we Dean, sorry.
Sorry
to interrupt you. I think perhaps you're sharing the main presenter screen instead of the share screen.
Oh, really?
Yep. We're looking at Dean Wellins, animation director, your first slide right now.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's weird. Let me go back. Can I go back? So it's not changing?
It's not changing. Maybe if you stop sharing and then reshare your
Let's
window.
Let's stop
again.
And reshare. Let's stop, and now that I have it going, let me reshare. Sorry about that.
All good.
Technical difficulties. We're going to get there. Okay. Well,
thank you, David, for flagging.
Yes, thank you. Yes. If anything goes awry, do not be shy about telling us.
Okay. There we go. That seems to be it.
Okay. Let me see. Does it change?
Yes.
Change to a new picture? Oh, good.
Yes. There we go. Now we can see your family.
There we go. There's a family I grew up with. And that's me when I was very little. And so, like I said, grew up in an Air Force family. My mom was an artist also and a musician and very talented herself. So I always say she gave me the talent she had in her little finger to become an artist. Eventually, my mom remarried and we moved to this little town right here called Dos Palos, which is literally in the middle of California. So all the pictures are changing. We're getting a map. All that good stuff's happening. Great. This is a very tiny town. Dos Palos is really known only for one thing. And besides, you know, its smallness is that it is basically a giant farm area, you know. And I grew up basically once I was about 12 years old, I was thrown out onto the farm. And lived in this farmhouse in the middle of nowhere. Went from the city to the middle of nowhere in this farmhouse. And even, you know, grew my own pumpkins and things like that. And so, you know, Dos Palos as a small town is basically known for one thing, and that is football. And it is actually third in the entire state of California for the most wins in a football team. If you see right there, it is number three of all-time wins, state champions of football. So that is what they're all about. Football, football, football. That's all they talk about. So an artist like me, there's not a lot of talk about art or film or anything like that. So I had a lot of time on my own to just kind of go out and look up at the stars out in the country and imagine worlds and imagine, you know, stories and things like that. But I really got fascinated with space and astrophysics and space travel and things like that. And I actually ended up leaving high school and going to UC Davis, which is up near Sacramento in California, and was going to do astronomy and physics and things like that. And I had a teacher there, but at the same time, you know, I'd kind of always been an artist. I'd kind of drawn characters and wrote stories and things like that, but never really thought of it as anything I could do as a job. You know, I never thought this could actually be a career. I need a real career. But one of my teachers who saw some of my work at UC Davis, he said, you know, you do this, you have very like animated sort of characters and things like that. And he just had a student he knew who had transferred from UC Davis to this other school called CalArts down in Valencia area in California. And maybe that might be a better fit for me than where I was at. So I said, okay, we'll think about that. And it was fun because, you know, with this teacher, we would talk about film. We would talk about our favorite films. And, you know, because I grew up on all these films. So Raiders of the Lost Ark, Star Wars, Close Encounters, even, you know, Totoro and all these animated classics like Pinocchio. And to me, to actually go to a school that actually taught animation would be incredible. And I was, you know, I was a fan of all these films. What I was really a fan of beyond Disney was even, you know, Warner Brothers. These were like when I was a kid growing up on Saturday mornings, this was like the ultimate sort of like animation fest for me. The Chuck Jones cartoons of the 40s and 50s to me were so funny and so appealing. And when I would draw characters, I would always be trying to, you know, ape his style, which I always thought was so beautiful and so funny and appealing. So I got all my drawings together and put them in a portfolio and said, well, I'm going to try for this CalArts place. And I hadn't even heard of it, but I'm going to try to get into it. And if they teach animation, okay, I'll go for it. And I actually got in to California Institute of the Arts down in Valencia. Me and basically 45 other men and very small amount of women. Out of 50 of us, I think there was only three women in our whole department. Now I think it's about 50-50. Might even be lean more towards women now. But it's crazy how now, like gender-wise, it's all kind of like become equal, when back then it was mostly guys. You know, a lot of these guys I still hang out with, still know, and they've become big industry, notables themselves. Even our animation teacher here at the top, this guy, who you might know, his name's Chris Buck, and he directed Frozen. So, you know, it was good early on to learn from these guys of, you know, what it took to be an animator, because that's basically what we wanted to be, were animators. And, you know, that was the goal. When you got to CalArts, you wanted to be a Disney animator or, you know, an animator. At the time, there was Don Bluth. There was no DreamWorks yet. That was before that time. There was only Don Bluth Studios and a couple other, Nelvana and some other ones. But Disney was the place to go. So that's what everybody wanted to do. We did get, though, an internship coming out of this. Ted Turner, who was this big sort of cable conglomerate guy, started up a feature animation studio called Turner Feature Animation. And a few of us actually got an internship to this movie called The Pagemaster. And it was like Macaulay Culkin's, I don't know, it was like some vehicle for him where he would be going into a magical world of books and libraries, and we'd go in the stories of all these books. But it was an animated movie, and we got pulled on as interns from CalArts for this movie, The Pagemaster. And we were, and the idea was that we would come in, and if we proved ourselves and we were able to, we'd actually get hired on as cleanup artists. And cleanup artists back in the day when it was all 2D animation, if you don't know, this is from Lilo and Stitch, but the idea is that an animator does rough drawings and then there's a cleanup artist that, you know, makes it clean so they can color it. So that was the idea, that we could clean up these drawings. But then I met this guy, Bruce Smith, and he was one of the animators on it. And
try to look at the actual video sessions that will be recorded, or the actor recorded, and see what were the things that they actually did in recording the dialogue. And then I just try to transfer those things onto the drawings, so that way I know that I'm hitting the same key, the same emotional key that they hit when they were actually recording the line of dialogue, and so that way it always syncs up with the action. When we get a layout.
So he was this amazing animator, and I'd never really heard of him until I got to it, but that guy really became like my like inspiration. Like his animation, when I'd watch him work, I would just stand in awe of his ability, and his, not his ability just to draw, but to be able to move a figure in space in 2D animation. And after a lot of me really being annoying, I said, I really want to animate a scene in this movie. I finally did, and this is
I really should be getting home here. Now.
Oh, I think you are home.
John Silver, touch one hair on that boy's head, and you'll be answering to me.
Welcome aboard, matey. Wouldn't happen to be going after me.
So from there, I went to Renegade Animation, and I learned a lot at Turner, but it was finally time to spread my wings. And I went to this place called Renegade, and they were a commercial house. So they did a bunch of commercials and things like that. And I really was their only real artist there. So when they got a job, this is a Dennis Rodman commercial that they did. I was the animator. So, you know, we would do all these things and I would animate the characters. And so these are all commercials way back when. And it's funny to look at it and realize how bad the tracking is on it, when today you can do better tracking on your phone. But back then they didn't have great tracking. So this was all like hard to actually do. And it took a lot of computer power, but it was fun. And I also did Chuck Jones, who was my hero. I actually got to work with him and work on this movie, this short called Pulitzer Surprise. And Pulitzer Surprise was this kind of old time throwback cartoon we did for Warner Brothers. And it was great because I got to storyboard, I got to write jokes, and I even got to animate on it. So now I'm starting to like build my sort of repertoire, my sort of like training that ultimately will lead to helping me be a better director down the road. And this was a big part of it. And after that, I really, really wanted to get into features and ended up at Warner Brothers Feature Animation and hooked up with this guy. The guy on the left there is Brad Bird, if you've ever heard of him. And the guy on the right side with the glass, or they both have glasses, the guy with no hat is actually the head of story. I'm in the middle. Brad is really known for The Simpsons, and of course he did all the Incredibles movies, and of course Ratatouille, and a lot of live action as well. And he's an incredible, incredible filmmaker. And he also did The Iron Giant, which was really my first big feature film where I was brought on as an animator. And I animated a lot of key scenes on it, and also ended up being in their story department, almost by accident, accidentally. They only had office space in the story area to sit. And so the head of story thought I was part of the story artist and started giving me scenes to storyboard when I wasn't supposed to. But then when Brad saw what I was doing, said, okay, he can keep storyboarding. So I actually ended up storyboarding probably about 50% of the movie. So all these little drawings here are from the sequence I did that I actually conceived of in the movie where the kid and the robot go out and swim at a lake together. We were working on the story and I just felt like there's just no fun in this movie. Like there's nothing that they just, they're always having to worry about sort of the big conflicts of the story, but isn't there just a moment where a kid and a robot can just play? And so I conceived of this scene here where Hogarth and, and the steam guy get to go out and
all right, we're watching,
you know, play in the lake.
This one's for professionals only.
And the great thing about this is I got to do all of it. I even got to animate all of Hogarth here.
No, thanks.
You, Weenie! Come on in! It's really, really refreshing!
So when
what? You too?
Storyboarded this.
You big baby!
And pitched it to Brad. Brad was like, oh, this has got to go in the movie. So it did. Anyway, it was a really fun scene to do. And I did a lot in that movie and it really taught me a lot about filmmaking, about writing, about story and animation, which was led by Tony Facilli, who's an amazing animator. And I even ended up in sort of the making of that they did a bunch of years later, of sort of like how this movie sort of came about, which I recommend. It's a very good read. So from that, I went to Walt Disney Animation Studios and, got on with this guy. You may have heard of him, maybe not. His name's Glenn Keane, and he was running the character of Long John Silver on Treasure Planet, and learned a lot from Glenn. Glenn and I became really good friends and really enjoyed each other's work and company, and he leaned on me a lot for Long John Silver. And John Ripa, who was the lead for Jim Hawkins, I would also lead on that character as well. And here's a little clip of a section that they gave me to work on. So this is about stuff I all animated when I was an animator.
Jibbo. Playing games? Are we?
Yeah. Yeah, we're playing games.
Oh, I see. Well, I was never much good at games. Always hated to lose.
Me too.
Anyway, it was a really great movie to work on. Got to work with Glenn. And even at my time at Disney, I met up with my old friend Bruce Smith again, who I met way back at the beginning of my career. And they were working on a movie called Princess and the Frog. And at the time, I really was kind of in between projects and said, you know, hey, I'll do some 2D animation. I'd done a lot of it by this time. And they said, well, what character you want to work on? And I said, well, I want to work with Bruce because he's still my inspiration. He's still the guy that made me want to be an animator. So I worked on Dr. Facilier, and this is one of the scenes I did with Dr. Facilier. From my friends on the other side. You can kind of see the progression here, how it got to the
used to asking for help from my friends on the other side.
And Bruce has just always been an inspiration, just an incredible artist. And so also my storyboarding that I had done on Iron Giant and things like that had, you know, people taken note of that as well. And soon I found myself sort of skipping out of this animation department at Disney and moving into the story department at Disney. Sort of doing storyboards. I storyboarded on Bolt. I storyboarded, I don't know if you know this movie, it's called Frozen. And one of the sequences they had, they were really rushed on. They're like, we have this song, it's called Let It Go, and we need this storyboarded in like 1 week. Like, we have to get it in production. And I basically took the song, and it was, you know, a demo, and I listened to it and storyboarded it, basically storyboarded what happens and what she does. And and really thought after that, it was a pretty good song. I don't know if any, you know, what'll happen with it. Had no idea that would become the juggernaut of a song that it finally did. But so I storyboarded that song, and it was surprising how big it became. Also did Big Hero 6, a lot of sequences in that. This is a one. This is kind of cool because you can kind of see side by side my board as to what happened.
Take this slow. Up.
Thrust. Too much thrust.
So this was something again that they gave me and said, we don't know exactly what to do, but maybe just do some fun stuff. So I basically conceived of this whole fly to San Francisco. San Francisco. But I did have to very much follow the map of real the San Francisco Bay Area to make sure I was flying geographically.
Our neurotransmitter levels are rising steadily.
Which means what?
The treatment is working.
Oh, no. No.
Anyway, can I go back up? There we go. So I did that. I did this Moana sequence where she goes over the reef and sings this other song that I thought might be big, which is How Far I'll Go. That turned out to be a big song as well. So we sort of worked on a lot of these key moments in movies. Zootopia, I boarded the end of it, you know, where they finally have this major conflict with the villain at the end. Actually got one of these babies from that, which is an Annie Award for storyboarding in that, which was really cool. And basically storyboarding was really giving me a lot of sort of, notice, and a lot of people were saying, should you direct something and things like that. So actually ended up developing with Glenn Keane again. We got back together and started developing Rapunzel. That eventually turned into Tangled down the road. Which is fine. It happens all the time. Movies get developed and then they kind of take a turn and go another way. But I got to do TikTok Tale, which was a short that I did for Disney. They wanted to do some shorts and said, did I have any ideas? I pitched one and they liked it. And it was basically about a little clock that, is kind of like the loser of his group of clocks in this clock shop, but sort of ends up saving the day. And it was great because now I'm actually directing. So I'm actually figuring out this whole process of moving from an idea all the way into creating a whole clock shop, all the different models that have to be built, all the different ways that the environments have to be built, how the characters will be built. And I would even do, this is a painting that I had done to sort of like give everybody the idea of what I was looking for. But I had to design everything myself for the short. I didn't get all the resources of Disney. And for shorts, you kind of have to do it yourself. And so I did. I actually did some 2D animation on it, but I did mostly just designs, some of the characters that then became models. And it was really cool to watch the process of sort of your 2D ideas becoming these 3D models and being able to, sort of as a director, lead the modeler to sort of find what we're looking for shape-wise and something that also can be rigged and animated eventually. And I storyboarded, of course, the whole thing. And I even had to, if you look here, if you notice there's times, I literally in my boards had to say, because it's clocks, like with every scene, what time it was, like, because they got to put the time on all the clocks literally in the short. So I had to go through and go, okay, now it's going to be like 11:05 and now it'll be so. Anyway. That's the thing you discover is that you're going to have to answer every question and every little tiny detail is going to have to be answered. So this is sort of if you haven't seen it, this is a little bit of it.
Oh.
So anyway, I recommend it's on Disney Plus if you want to check it out. It's I think it was a really fun short. We had a lot of fun making it. So I developed a lot of different ideas. Eventually I landed on this movie called Raya and the Last Dragon. When I got onto it, it had a different name, but the final sort of title was Raya and the Last Dragon. And Raya and the Last Dragon was where I really learned that, you know, the key to, you know, really getting authenticity in your films and in what you're doing is through research. And we actually went to Southeast Asia because Raya and the Last Dragon, even though it's a fantasy film, the cultures and the sort of inspirations and motifs, we really wanted to pull from Southeast Asia. So we took a few trips there and we really, you know, immersed ourselves in those worlds, not just took, you know, didn't just stay in hotels and just do things. We really like met with families. We met with, you know, people and spiritual leaders and things like that, just to really understand that part of the world. Because we just want to educate ourselves and make sure that, again, that we had that level of authenticity, that anybody from that part of the world would look at this movie and be able to understand those little things, those little bit of details we put in that really make it relatable for them. So, and these are some of my things. So, you know, we would do trips and we would take notes and we would just note every little thing we could see. And from all, this was from Bali. We went to Bali and I took a bunch of notes on the rituals and what everything meant and even did a lot of my own sketching of people around that I saw, you know, cause we were going to design characters and we needed to know, you know, how this was all going to translate into a Disney film. Eventually it did, and we started doing storyboards and we started, you know, creating the characters. And these are a lot of the initial drawings that I had done early on, as the director of pre-production, and just sort of getting, Raya's look and Boone's look. And, you know, eventually that moves into like CG, and now modelers are now having to, you know, take the drawings that you're doing and are designers are putting things together to, you know, basically, again, translating from all that information that you built up, all that, you know, all the research you've done, all the notes you've taken, to try to make something that is its own world, but again, harkens back and takes a lot of its inspiration from Southeast Asia. So these are a lot of drawovers that I had done and characters that, you know, we had all led. You know, in our art department, you know, they also went and come back and start doing paintings and things like that, based on, you know, the inspiration they got from being, you know, in that part of the world, which was really exciting. And then of course, you know, as we're doing this, you know, the, you know, we're hiring actors, we're starting to bring in the talent, and tuck, tuck. This is some of them reporting.
You're getting a little too big for this spot.
Plenty of.
Oh, mighty Sisu.
Who said that? Hello? Hello?
I gotta admit, Raya, until a few months ago, I thought you were stone, but then someone stole Fang's dragon scroll. Mother, you won't believe what I saw. It was Sisu.
Anyway, so it was really cool. We got, you know, we're recording voices now, and, my co-director Paul and I started, we were directing a teaser for the movie. So this is a little sort of a snippet of kind of what goes on as you're actually doing this in the studio. And I'll just play it a little bit. And
I think the whole sense of it, but obscure as high, I think is all.
But I think that idea, that thinking of like whatever just sells the dramatic, as opposed to the record scratch of this kid.
So everybody that's here in this meeting,
unlike a drawing,
we are helping them understand what we're trying to get across in the story.
I think here, at the storyboard, she can be like,
and all the people in that room are leaders of development, leaders of, you know, characters, of environments, just so that they know what they need to do.
So we have
start making the move.
Brendan will be working on
and now this part is we're all now starting to look at animation and we're starting to make notes, and we have a little laser pointer. We can actually point up at the screen of things that we see that may need fixing or may need some enhancement or exploration.
All this dust pretty much blowing out of the way. So it's more just the heat ripple.
But again, we were always inclusive that everybody, and that was actually unique because a lot of the time, we actually, in meetings where we have animation, we're looking at animation, we wanted to make sure that everybody from all the different departments were there so they could all hear what we're trying to do, so that when these scenes went through animation and went down the line and got to them, they understood what the initial point of it was. Because a lot of the time that didn't happen. They just got scenes and, you know, had to kind of do their own, you know, sort of investigation as to where the scene, how it was conceived, where it needs to be in the movie. But we really wanted to give everybody context, all the leaders of all the art departments and things like that. And I realize this is going a long time, so that's good. But I'm going to play a little bit of this. So this is what we ended up with. Really, we had a lot of fun making it, and the movie came out good, and just really proud of, I think, of putting up something on screen that, you know, spoke to that part of the world, because it was really inspirational. Go there, and it's a long way away, but I have to say, if you ever get a chance to ever go to any part of Asia, certainly where we went in Southeast Asia, Cambodia, and Thailand, those areas, beautiful parts of the world, I highly recommend it on your travels someday in your life. So from there, I got onto the Baymax series, and this was a spinoff of Big Hero 6. So, you know, I'd worked on Big Hero 6 as a storyboard artist early on, and now I got a chance to direct a series. And this was super exciting because this is the first series that Disney Plus had ever done. So, you know, I got to finally just really stretch my legs as a director. I kind of oversaw the entire series, but then directed three of the six things myself. So I think, you know, after all this, I could kind of put together now really what a director, animation director's job is. And, you know, so a director has many hats. The main one is going to be with a producer and associate producer. And the producer is basically the person that's overseeing how this is going to get made. You know what I mean? This is the person that is dealing with the people above us, the studio heads, but also sort of all the production people, production managers, all the way through the supervisors, all the people that are basically shepherding all the artists to create and to, you know, on a timely manner, finish what we need to finish. And the associate producer is somebody who's similar role, but more boots on the ground, that they're really interacting regularly with a lot of the main production leadership. And then on the creative side, number one is the writer. We get a writer on. We had Adele Lim on Raya and the Last Dragon. And the writer, and then we get a head of story. For Baymax, there was no head of story pretty much because we kind of boarded them ourselves. But certainly we had an editor, and that loop is something that is super important to kind of the creation of the story, and all, you know, all the timing and writing and jokes and character development and all that. The story, which is, again, story is king. And then the production designer, the art director, and the character designer are now the group that are going to create the characters, what they're going to look like. The Baymax series, obviously, we, you know, brought a lot of the models from the movie and just reused them. But we had a few new characters that we had to build and create sort of one-offs. So there was a certain amount of that we also had to do, but certainly the whole look of it still needed a production designer and art director to sort of lead the way. The other big one is obviously the VFX supervisor, who's sort of overseeing, you know, from in a CG pipeline, how you're going to get from these storyboards that have been created to a final look and a final film that looks, you know, as good as any Disney movie that has ever been made. And the third part of that sort of, you know, triad is the head of animation, sort of an important role, as they usually lead, you know, on a feature that could be up towards of 100 people. I think on Baymax we had like about maybe 20-25 people as animators, and then, you know, and animation leads. But, you know, again, they're all interacting also with modelers, with, you know, head of modeling, rigging, look development, simulations, environments, all those other things to kind of get everything right. And then there's also casting director who's helping us, you know, get the voices. And then the composer, who was this guy, Damian Lewis, who did an amazing job on this. And, you know, our writer was this woman named Scirocco Dunlap, and she did an amazing job. And there's a little bit of the script, you know, that we would pull from, and we would do recording sessions, just like you saw in Raya. Of course, we did this all through Zoom. This was all during COVID. So this whole series was created, basically, I was at my dining room table, the entire thing. Never went into work ever. Which is amazing what you can do from home, but you can these days. But we did that, and Scirocco did a great job, and she even won an Emmy for doing her writing on Baymax, which was very exciting. And you know, I storyboarded basically all of my own, you know, series episodes and things like that. You know, so there's some of the gags and some of the writing comes out of my storyboards, but then Scirocco would go back and forth, and the two of us would kind of land on what would it would finally be. And then finally that would turn into animation. And this is sort of like a little rough. So this is sort of early on test where there's no lighting or anything like that. This is the Kiko character. And Baymax has just come and sort of interjected himself into her life. And she's not very happy about it. And then these would be drawn, so the animator would show something at that level, and then I might do some drawovers. So these are drawovers that I would do to kind of get the feeling or the acting that I want to, you know, get from it. And, you know, even though I'm the director, again, being an animator myself for so long, I have that skill. I have that ability to be able to draw what I see in my head as far as being the acting or whatever little subtleties that I want to put into, you know, the character's look or how they're interacting, or, you know, just in general attitude that I'm looking for. Or, and sometimes, even though a model is a CG virtual thing, you can actually, some people can actually manipulate it in a not appealing way. So sometimes you have to kind of lead them to something that's a little bit more appealing. So yeah, so this is sort of a little.
Hello, I am Baymax, your personal health.
What's that? Borax?
I am Baymax, your.
So yeah, so Baymax came out great. We actually were nominated for a few Emmys, which was really fun. And that's something as an animation director, you also have to expect, is that you're going to get in front of a lot of people. If you're an introvert, and you don't like talking in big rooms or talking in class with everybody else listening, you're going to have to get over that, because you're going to have to talk to a lot of people and sort of be the one with the spotlight on you. And, you know, This was.
Now, you're here at the Children's and Families Emmys Awards. Obviously, typically at Walt Disney Animation Studios, you're producing content that didn't historically go to direct to streaming or direct to TV. So this is probably a.
And, you know, and then we have big things where we're at D23 and all the, you know, people are looking at us and cameras are shooting, and even being at award shows and things like that, and being in front of tons of people. But in the end, really, it's just about a giant group of people making something that we're really all proud of. And certainly Baymax was definitely that. And now I go on and worry about the next thing that I have to do. So yeah, so that's, there it is. Actually, I went pretty close, but anyway.
That was great, Dean. Thank you so much. It was so great to see all the behind the scenes.
storyboards and how those transformed into the final animations. Very cool to witness.
Yeah. Glad everybody can enjoy it.
All right. So I know that we've got some questions filling in our Q&A box.
I'm ready.
So let's tackle some of those together. Let's see. So we have Jenny who asked, could you go into the process of what you and Glenn did when developing the concept for Rapunzel and how what you did affected the final product?
Glenn had already been working on Rapunzel for a while. I had done a little bit of storyboarding for him, and then he really wanted me to come on and co-direct it with him because he felt like we both had a very similar vision for what this could be. And our take was a little bit more dark and gritty. It was it's a girl who's trapped in a tower. So it's not a happy thing, you know what I mean? A wicked woman is basically trapping somebody, you know, and brainwashing a young girl in this tower. So our take was a little, you know, like I said, a little more edgy, a little darker, but still with, you know, music and things like that. And I guess if you compare it to, like, you know, when you first meet the Beast in Beauty and the Beast, you know, it's pretty scary. It's coming out of the dark, and it's got that sort of a little bit of edge to it. And I think in the end, you know, I think they were looking for something that really just wanted to be much more playful and a little bit more sort of just not as deep, I guess you could say. But I actually did end up storyboarding the end of that movie. Even Tangled, when it came out, I came back and storyboarded some of that to help them out. But I would say and I had actually written the first draft of the script for that, the original Rapunzel. So a lot of those story turns and a lot of the things that happened in Tangled, you know, certainly with the mother, tricking her into believing these monsters are out there and getting, you know, doing all the things, the manipulations were very much from what we had done. So it came, large amount of the DNA of Tangled is still from the Rapunzel that Glenn and I had originally started developing.
That definitely sounds like a common challenge, I think, for directors, right? Just yes. Steering that vision along and trying to connect all these different pieces and tones too.
Yeah. And, you know, I think sometimes you want to be able to appeal to everybody, but you know, you're not going to please everyone. And really you just have to please yourself. Yeah. In a sense of, you just have to do what makes you feel good. What thing you want to, you put things on screens that you would want to see. And if others don't agree, then others don't agree. That's just the way it goes. But at a certain point, you just have to believe that your vision is worthy of it and stick to it as much as you can. But also listening, you can't be so blind to what other people are saying, or closing your ears off to others. You know, if you're getting a majority of people saying, I see what you're doing, but boy, it doesn't really work for me. You have to take that into account. You have to go back and go, okay, something's not quite right here. And what I thought it was, maybe it needs to be something different. So that is a huge part of directing, is staying the course, but at the same time, you know, being receptive of what people are feeling about it and what it ultimately needs to be.
Is very, that kind of answers Daniela's question here.
Okay.
Who asks, when you're directing at a big collaborative movie, how do you balance hearing everyone's input while maintaining your own voice as a director?
Yeah, it's hard, you know. Pete, I know Pete Docter pretty well, and up at Pixar, and Andrew Stanton, you know, did Nemo and Wally and all that. And Pete Docter would always say that Andrew Stanton was he was funny in the way that he would be the director who's like, we're going this way. This is the direction. I know it in my heart. And then a bunch of people go, well, I don't know. Maybe it isn't like this. And then he'd kind of go, yeah, well, man, maybe he's not. This way. This is the direction. This is what I feel in my heart. So he would be able to shift and know something. But then once he was, you know, committed, he's committed. And we're going to go in this direction until some obstacle tells us we're going the wrong way. But, you know, the beauty of animation is having storyboarding and story reels. You know, that's the thing that you put up, and either that works or that doesn't work. And you, and if you're in a, you know, a theater of, you know, 100 people all watching your story reels and you're the only one laughing, you need to figure some other way of delivering what you're envisioning, because it ain't working for everybody else. And it happens. I've been there. And yeah, you just have to be receptive and just kind of read the tea leaves a little bit, but a vision's important too. It's a balance for sure.
For sure. Speaking about direction, another way to think about direction, I think that the path to becoming a director can be a bit ambiguous or circuitous at times. Yeah. Is there a common path to get to, you know, where you've been, where you are now? We have Lizette in the chat who asked, I mostly focus on visual development work, specifically character design, but it is hard to get into the industry for VizDev. Mm-hmm. Would you suggest I do storyboarding instead to get into the industry? Wondering how, you know, if choosing a certain path from the outset helps you get to that directing chair.
Well, I mean, you know, no doubt storyboarders are way more in demand than VizDev people. But I will say that if you're a good VizDev person, you'll get a job. I mean, you know, it's like they say in Hollywood with scripts, you know, that everybody has a movie script to sell, but at the same time, if it's really good, it'll get made because most of them are not that great. But storyboarding, it is a path, certainly. And certainly if you're a storyteller and you're somebody who likes to do that and likes to write, I mean, storyboarding, you kind of have to do it all. You have to be sometimes a character designer. Sometimes you have to be a world designer, a writer, somebody who does VizDev a little bit. Because certainly you get sometimes sequences that have nothing. They give you nothing. We have no environment for this. We don't know where this takes place, or we know where it takes place. We don't know what it looks like. So you have to do a lot of that. But I would say if you were, you know, VizDev is the way you want to go. I think there's a path to it. The thing that I tell people that want to do VizDev, because I've looked at a lot of VizDev, certainly over my time as a director and working on films, the stuff that always stands out to me, and certainly the stuff that's well done, you know, rendered well, and it's visually well done, is stuff that has story to it. There's like, you lean in, like you want to know what's happening. A lot of time I see VizDev and it's just a pretty landscape and you go, it's cool, but it's not like compelling in a story way. And when you get into features and things like that, I mean, VizDev, yes, it is, you know, obviously rendering, you know, beautiful paintings and things, but at the same time, it should also be compelling part of the story, something that makes you lean in and go, I want to see that. Like, I want to see what happens in this part of the movie just from this one painting, because it looks very interesting of how this person's falling and they're holding on this other person. And it looks like there's tension there. Or I would just say, try to get an emotion out of it. Like, try to get either a sense of fear or a sense of laughing or, you know, or comedy or anything. That layer I see missing in a lot of VizDev that I look on, you know, in art stations, and there's beautiful paintings. You go, oh, that's really well done. It's a car sitting in front of a house. Okay, great. It's a well-done car. It's a good house. Other than that, I'm not really that interested, you know.
That's a great tip. to try to infuse story and emotion into, even if it is biz dev, into those components.
Yeah, and every step of the way. Working on our films, every person at every level, we always say, you're a storyteller. You're helping us, whether you're a lighter, you're a rigger, whatever you're doing, you're helping us tell this story. With your little bit, you're helping us. So please just put story into it. And it'll, and people will be like, oh, I want to see the next one. Oh, I want to see the next one. You know, when they're flipping through your, I did this because we had portfolios in the old days and now we don't have those, but that was, yes, that was an old guy move. This. Anyway.
All right. Well, whether it's biz dev, story, or even animating, we have Josh here who asks, I did a process on animations before as a student. I got burnt out on my animation by myself with a little help from my advisor. Any tips on getting back to the groove along with bringing animation back to my habit?
So like, is this like doing like 2D animation, like, or like CG animation, or just is it, are you, is it,
I guess, Josh, feel free to jump in the chat.
Yeah, is it
CGI and 2D animation?
I guess it's, I mean, you got to animate things that are, you know, that are fun to do. I mean, I guess that's the thing, is if you're like, well, I'm just doing walk cycles for the past year. Yeah, that'd be, I'd probably burn out in that pretty quickly. Or if you're just doing just calisthenics or something where a character's just moving around, you know, I always, to me, whenever I want to like do something where I want to show off a character or have fun with something, just find, like, go to your favorite, you know, TV show, The Office or something like that, and find a snippet of dialogue and just animate to it, you know. And to me, that's fun because you can actually, you know, now you're actually doing something you already, you know, have an affinity for. But now you get to sort of like, you know, animate it in your own way with your own character or something like that. You do, sometimes you just got to make it fun for yourself and do things that are fun for you.
And I think that really allows you to allow your energy to shine through your project as well. When you're having fun.
Oh yeah, for sure.
That translates into your artwork as well.
Oh yeah, definitely.
All right, well, we are just a minute over. I want to respect everyone's time, including yours, Dean. Thank you so much for taking the time to host this presentation for us. It's been so enriching to hear about your journey and life as an animation director.
Yeah, awesome. And, you know, if there's any last questions, I can answer them. I'm not going anywhere, but if we need to call it, you can say so.
Yeah, sure. If you want to stick around for 5 more minutes to answer the remaining questions. Yeah, just give
it. I feel like I went almost 5 minutes over on my thing, so I feel like I want to give it back.
Sure. Okay. Let's see. We've got another question from Joshua. How many changes does each storyboard happen? Wait, how many changes each storyboard will happen towards the final result? I guess how many changes?
Oh God.
Yeah.
Well, it's just, I mean,
in this process.
Disney, well, I'd say probably most places now are notorious for self-annihilation and storyboards. You know, we've put up entire films from beginning to end in storyboard and redone the entire thing from scrapped everything. And you're talking, you know, 50, 60,000 drawings out, gone, bye, erase. New ones. You know, I would say a sequence in a film, if it survives, again, sometimes a sequence is in a film in real one, and by the time you've had your fifth screening, that sequence isn't even there anymore. If a sequence has survived all the screenings, you know, that's going to be, usually there's 5 or 6 screenings per, you know, that a film goes through. Well, probably on average, I say. So you could probably look at 5 or 6 different iterations of a sequence, even Let It Go. I wasn't the first one to work on it. There's a guy named Norm LeMay, who is still an artist at Disney. He did the first version of it. And his stuff's beautiful. I think tonally it wasn't quite the way they wanted to go. and then were up against the gun, so they gave it to me to take a crack at it. So, they go through a lot. Yeah.
All right. Another question we have from an anonymous attendee. How big is the market for animation shorts? What's the purpose for big studios to make shorts?
Well, there's not a big reason to make shorts, and a lot of them aren't doing it anymore, which is kind of sad. I felt like the purpose a lot of the time, certainly when I was there, was doing a short, was to sort of grow the leadership. So people that have a lot of talent or things like that, or certainly even directing, gives them a chance to do something in short form without committing to a full feature of somebody who's never directed anything before, but also somebody who's never done head of animation before, somebody who's never been a lighting supervisor before. It's a great opportunity for people within a studio who've been sort of just, you know, a regular lighter, but really showed, you know, great, you know, instincts and great artistry, to say, let's give them a chance to see if they can lead a group of lighters. And so that, to me, was the big, you know, win of having shorts, was that's how you grew your sort of leadership inside the studio. And that also tested out some different pipelines
for you as well on your short, right? As a first time director.
Yeah, absolutely. And my short, the clock short we did, almost everybody on it were like trainees. Like, they weren't even full employees yet. And yet almost every single one of them is a supervisor now. Wow. They were all trainees, like just out of like, I think, second year in college trainees. But now they're all big wig Disney supervisors now.
That's a great opportunity.
It is, and that's what it did, what it was supposed to do.
All right. One other question we have here is, what are the most important qualities to be an animation director? I have some experience in live action film. I would like to know how this is different for animation, and if understanding specific areas would be helpful, such as screenwriting, storyboarding, animation, biz dev, to transfer these skills to animation.
Well, the second part, yes, all those things. Do all those things. Writing, do lots of writing. Do lots of storyboarding, because that's where filmmaking comes in and all that. I would say, you know, it probably varies with different sort of people who direct live action, but, you know, animation is, I think, in its DNA, very collaborative. So everybody, like, a good idea can come from everywhere, anywhere. And so it really is just a bunch of minds all putting together our whole, even in animation, we have a story team. So we have a whole, you know, 20 storyboarders, 10 to 20 storyboarders who are not just storyboarding, but they're in the room helping us shape the film. You know, is this feel right? Does this feel wrong? Everybody in the room says, I hate that part, or everybody says, I love that part. So, you know, this is helping you steer towards the final film. I think that's, to me, is the biggest difference, in the core of what makes an animated film. But then there's also, you know, live action, you know, there's a lot of spontaneity, you know what I mean? With an actor, who knows what they're going to do? Could be good, could be bad. In animation, every eye blink, there's no spontaneity. You are simulating spontaneity, but there's none. You know every single little action that's going to happen, and everything needs to be decided. So the level of detail that a director in animation needs to make decisions and give notes is on a much higher resolution than I think a lot of live action, like regular live action movies.
Right. That sounds like a big distinction.
It is. Yeah.
All right. And then final question from Daniela, who asks, any practical tips for making sure a story stays targeted towards all ages instead and doesn't end up skewing too young?
Well, I assume that Daniela is a, you know, teenager. I would say it should appeal to you. Like, you know, I mean, when I do things, I don't second guess my audience or go, well, this seems really, you know, cheesy and dumb, but I guess a three-year-old will like it. I never say that to myself. Whatever I put up on screen is something that I think is funny, or I think is heartwarming, or I think is scary, or I think is any emotion that I would have, then I would, I hope everybody else has. That's all I can rely on. That's all you can rely on is your own instincts of, well, when I have this character do this, or I have this situation happen, I feel a certain way. I just have to have faith that whoever watches this will have that same feeling. So I wouldn't try to second guess anything, or try to skew it towards any certain age. You just got to do what you would want to see yourself. Like if it's like some, like if you were to sit down in a theater and you're the only one that ever gets to see it, but you're going to enjoy it, that's what you need to make. And then it'll be for everybody. And I will also say that kids are way smarter than we think they are. And chances are most kids don't want to see things that are their age. They want to see things that are for teenagers or things like that. Yeah, for my own kid who's 15, I was like, hey, my friends want to come over and watch Saltburn. I was like, no, you're not all watching. My God. So yeah, they never want to watch things that's, you know, for their age. Anyway, yeah.
Hopefully. Great. Well, that wraps up all of our Q&As, our questions that we've received. Dean, thank you so much for staying over a bit extra. And thank you to our attendees for also staying to hear the rest of these answers as well.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you, everybody. Yeah. Thanks for having me. And to everybody out there, and you want to be getting into animation, it's kind of been in a slump, but I think it's getting better. And I think you're in a good time right now. So push your art, push yourself, and tell stories best you can.
Speaking of pushing and not giving up, just a final reminder to our attendees, the Bric Foundation is a two-day event that is coming up March 15th and 16th with opportunities for networking and more industry career learning just like this. So definitely feel free to visit our website, bricfoundation.org, to find out how you can attend. Sign up for portfolio reviews as well if you're an aspiring artist. And we hope to see you there. Thank you so much, everyone.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you, Dean.
All right.
Have a good day, everyone.